Good morning, Harbor. Good morning. It is so nice to hear our sanctuary so full of life and chatter as we fill in. Good morning to those on Zoom as well. We're going to go ahead and get started in our worship together this morning. First, starting by inviting in our acolyte. Oh, yeah. Jeanette, thank you for bringing our light in this morning. We are all children of God, that's right. Give a round of applause. Thank you, Pastor Jeanette, for a very rare lighting. And for the rest of us, let's go ahead and get in our seats, stand up out of our seats. And for those on Zoom, sit up straight as we open in song with This Is Amazing Grace.
Who breaks the power of sin and darkness? Whose love is mighty? So much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder and leaves us breathless in our wonder, the King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
You would bear my cross. You lay down.
Beautiful this morning, church. Go ahead and say good morning to each other. Feel free to keep saying good morning and catching up as we start our second worship song today. Please stay standing and feel free to join in when you're ready for the beauty of the earth.
For the beauty of the earth.
Amen, church. Please be seated.
Thank you, praise band. Beautiful. Hello, good morning, everyone. Please join me in our call to worship with reading the bolded words. When we come to this space, we bring all of ourselves. We bring joy and hope, dreams and prayers, grief and doubt, memories and heartache. God meets us here. God hears our prayers and sees our scars. With open hearts and authenticity, let us worship good and gracious God. One of my favorite parts of being here at church is the smiles I see each morning. The laughter of gathering, the many, many conversations while Lauren is trying to get us back together for our second song. The catching up, the how are you, the how did that appointment go, the what are you doing in school now, the excitement, the joy. When we are here, there is so much space for joy. When we are here, there's also space for sadness and grief. Today, our scripture takes us to topics that are not easy to talk about and that we often want to push aside. Another of my favorite parts of church is that I know I am not alone in any of my sadness, and neither are you. I know that church, when we are in community with each other and with God, that we can hold all of our very human emotions, the joy, the hurt, and the pain. Please join me in reading our prayer of confession. God of creation, humanity is capable of such evil. Stories in scripture alongside stories on the news remind us of that truth all the time. For the moments when we choose violence over peace, exclusion over inclusion, and fear over hope, forgive us. When we choose pride over what is right and comfort over justice, show us mercy. And when we numb our pain instead of leaning into empathy, unravel us, for we long to be changed. Gratefully we pray, amen. Amen. I'm going to call up our children in just a moment, but I want to single out a couple very special birthdays. I don't see Heather in the house right now, but her birthday is tomorrow, along with our very own Pastor Sadie. Happy birthday. We are so grateful for you and all that you do and hold for us, so we hope that it is a lovely day and that you get very spoiled by your family. Hint, hint. I would now like to call up all of our children and youth for a moment before children's church. Come on up, Simone. It's your turn. Hi there. Welcome back. Where do you want to sit?
Here.
You want to sit there?
Happy birthday, Heather.
Heather, you just missed your happy birthday. We have a very fun day today. For those of you who are joining us after church, we're going to the beach. Who here is going to the beach with us today? Yes, quite a few of us. So we're going to pray for a little bit more sun so it's a little warmer when we go out there. But just wanted to give that reminder after church. We'll figure out the carpool situation. Both Max and I will be driving, but we may need another parent to do a drop-off just because parking is so bad there at the beach. But we have that coming up after church today. And next week after church, typically we have our youth group every week, but it's Father's Day next Sunday. And so we will be having that day off so that you can celebrate with some special people in your life. Today, here in Big Church, we're going to be talking about some heavier things. But I think there is something that we have all experienced before. Has anyone here ever felt sad? Angelina's like, duh, of course we have. Everyone has felt that before, right? And there's a lot of different reasons for why we become sad. Sometimes it's really, really heavy stuff. Someone we love passes away. Or maybe something like you go to a new school and now you have a whole new set of friends. Or maybe it's just something that you were hoping and expecting for didn't happen. I wonder what helps you feel better when you are sad. Angelina, you want to share? Let me get to the microphone.
My dog?
Your dog. Absolutely. Pets definitely help us in many ways. Anyone else? What might make you feel a little better when you're feeling sad? Anyone have one? Yeah, Shelby. Bring it over.
I like writing.
Writing, yeah. Getting out all of the emotions, all of the feelings. Sometimes that helps process the sadness. Yeah, or just sit with it. Anyone else? One more. What might help us feel a little better? Yeah, you wanna share?
My cousin Maeve.
What, can you say that again?
My cousin Maeve.
Your cousin Maeve, pointing. Beautiful, yes. Family, our friends, they help us so that when we're sad, it doesn't feel so heavy, right? When we have someone that we either vent out to or we call or we text or whatever it may be, or we go to our parents and we say, I'm really sad about this. It may not make it 100% better. It may not take away what is happening. But when you're able to share what you're feeling, you know that you're not holding it alone. One of the things I love doing is praying. Right? We can pray at any time, at any place. You don't need any special words to pray. You just talk to God. You can say, God, I'm really sad about this thing. I thought this was going to happen and it didn't. Or I now don't get to see this friend anymore. And God is there for us. And God is there for us through community as well. And so in Children's Church today, we're going to hear a different story of what's happening in Big Church. But as we head into our two different church spaces that we're having, I want you to think about the ways that you have been helped. We heard some of them. Our pets, our friends, writing it out. I wonder how you can help someone else feel a little bit better. It's not taking it all away from them. It's not fixing everything, but maybe it's just some kind words. Maybe someone at your school falls and hurts themselves and they're sad and crying. I've done that. And I've had friends who comfort me in those moments. And so you can do that as well. So let's think about that as we head into Children's Church. Are we ready for worship? Yes, let's go. Are you ready, Simone? Will you share with us in Children's Church?
No.
Can you do me a favor and give this microphone to your mom?
Okay.
We're going to call up your mom for a mission moment next. Will you give it to her? You want to ask your mom to come up?
No.
Where are we going?
Hi, everyone.
Hi, everyone. Say, this is my mom.
This is my mom.
And she's doing mission moment today.
Mission moment today.
Yes. Good job, Simone. You ready?
Hi, everyone. I'm Ray Hauer. My husband, Nate Haken, was supposed to be the one here today doing the mission moment, but he's still in Cote d'Ivoire, West Africa. He's coming home tomorrow. Yay. But So I'm what you have today. He'll do it another time. So I'm a student at UCI. I'm studying disability in the sociology department, and I'm studying it in low and middle income countries like Cote d'Ivoire. And I take the perspective in my research that disability is diversity. And so when we think about disability, we don't think of it as, in the context of church, I mean. I would encourage us not to think of disability as something that we minister to, but that people with disabilities are part of our community and they're people that we minister with. And I wanted to give a few examples of disabled people in the Bible. And just a quick, disclaimer that the Bible was written thousands of years ago in another culture, so I am naming some people in the Bible. We don't necessarily want to copy everything that they did, but I'm thinking of, in particular, where is it? The son of Dan. Oh, yeah, Chushim, the son of Dan. He was deaf, and he's famous for killing Esau, so we're not going to do that, but anyway. So other people in the Bible are Isaac was blind in his old age. And by the way, people in older age with disability, they're people too. So sometimes we just disregard them. Jacob limped. And in his old age, he was also half blind. We've already mentioned Chushim. Moses stuttered, but still was able to lead the Israelites. Samson was born with a limp, and he died blind. Ehud had a shriveled right hand, and this is another example. He was left-handed because of it and was able to kill the king of the Moabites, which was a cool advantage that he had there. But again, something from a long time ago. And then King Saul's grandson, Mephibosheth, couldn't walk. Also, some people believe in the New Testament that Matthew, one of the disciples, is sometimes portrayed as being autistic, and that James had a physical disability. Of course, we know Paul is famous for having his thorn in the flesh, so he had a chronic pain, maybe a chronic illness. And Zacchaeus was someone with very short stature, so short that he couldn't see when he was behind the crowd. He had to climb a tree to see Jesus. Even Jesus, after Jesus was resurrected, his body was still disfigured. He still had wounds in his hands and feet and side. These are just examples of people in the Bible who were part of the ministry of the Bible and with their disability, not in spite of their disability or... I mean, in the case of the left-hander, it was because of their disability. But just encouraging us to think of people with disability as part of our community, which Harbor Church does a really good job with. Of course, disabled people do need help sometimes, and we all need help sometimes. Everyone needs help. And this is the concept of interdependence. We all depend on each other. We all rely on each other at different times. I certainly have relied a lot on this community, especially when my husband travels. Shout out to Nan, who helped me so much with my kids in school, and also the other friends. Thank you. Yeah, clap. And the other parents from our school also who are here have helped so much. Harbor Church is a beautiful place of interdependence, and if you would like to contribute to our community of interdependence, you can do so online or in the back. Thank you. Okay, let's pray. Dear God, thank you so much for our beautiful community here at Harbor and for your beautiful world and the way that you love us all. Pray that you would use our gifts to help us to continue to minister to each other, to everyone, and then also to minister to people outside of our immediate community here. Amen.
Wow, thank you, Ray, for that beautiful message. Oops. Oh, boy. All right. Well, we're going to pray. But before we pray, doesn't our sanctuary look beautiful?
Yeah.
Let's give a hand to those who decorated. And remembering that this month is Pride Month, that we at Harbor celebrate all kinds of diversity. So thank you so much to Judy and Gary, and who else helped with this? Nan? No? Judy's saying Nan helped. That means Nan helped in some way. Probably not as much as getting on the ladder like Gary, but we're very... And Lauren helped, so it looks beautiful. Thank you so much. We're going to have reminders all through the month of diversity and how beautiful it is to just let people be who they are and love them just as they are. Does anyone have prayers this morning that they would like to lift up? Mary Ellen, start with you.
I'd like to ask for prayers for my daughter-in-law, Dawn Frawley. She's leaving on Tuesday for Africa for a ministry there. So,
all right, let's be praying for Dawn, for travel mercies and safety while she's abroad. Justin, and then I thought I saw a hand over here. Heather, we'll get to you next.
I have a prayer of gratitude. It was my dad's 67th birthday on Friday, and I helped my mom and some neighbors with setting up a birthday party for him. And we had 55 people show up to celebrate him. And it just brought me so much joy to see that my folks in their time in life they're at have such a robust community supporting them. And so many people don't have that, you know, as people get into their older age. So I'm just super grateful to see my parents thriving in that way.
What a blessing. Thanks for sharing, Justin. Heather?
So I have a couple of things. First of all, David will be traveling home tonight. He's been gone since Tuesday or Wednesday? Wednesday, I think. So it'll be nice to have him back, and just prayers for a safe trip. He's on the East Coast at a conference. Secondly, tomorrow Nicholas starts the State Parks Ocean Lifeguard Academy.
Yay, Nicholas!
A big deal, and just prayers for him, for his health and strength and, you know, mental fortitude to get through. This time next week, he'll be like 48 hours away from the end, so, yeah.
Nicholas, we'll be praying for you all through it.
And then to add to all of that, Gabriella wanted me to share, because she's back in the kids' church. We just got a call 2 days ago from Make-A-Wish that her wish is finally being granted, which is a huge deal.
Wow.
And so Saturday, she and I will be flying to New York City to attend the Tony Awards and have an experience all around that. That's been her wish that she made a long time ago, and we don't know all of the details yet, but we know we're going, so it's a big deal. Yeah,
I'm getting tearful. This is amazing. Wow. Thank you for sharing, Heather. We'll be praying for you guys on your travels, too. Did you have a prayer?
I have a prayer request for my
First of all, this is Rachel. Rachel's new, for anyone who doesn't know, so... Go ahead, Rachel.
This is our second time here, and we have a son who has not attended with us yet. He's at home this morning. He's 13. His name is Oliver. He has an autoimmune condition. It's basically autoimmune encephalitis, so he has inflammation in the brain. Mm-hmm. And it was recently diagnosed about 6 months ago, so that's kind of taken over our lives. But he's having his very first infusion treatment. It's an IV treatment at home over 2 days. It goes about 5 hours over 2 days, and that's his first time doing that. So it's kind of a big deal for us, so just appreciate prayers for him. That's on Thursday and Friday this week.
We'll be praying for Oliver and for all of you. Thank you for sharing. Thank you so much for sharing. Does anyone else like to pray, Bronwyn?
Hi, good morning. I just wanted to celebrate Silas graduated from high school this week, which, hooray, made it. And I have a lot of dear family that's been with us. My parents left yesterday, but my sister and sister-in-law and nieces. And so it has just been sweet, and thinking back on how God has met and carried Silas and so many, and me and all of us, at so many points. So,
thank you for sharing. We're so happy for him and so glad you all could come and spend time. Other prayers this morning? Seton.
A couple of prayers. So I'm entering my finals week this week. So please pray for me. I have a lot to do in this one week, a few days. But I'm very excited. I will be graduating on Friday.
Yay!
And, yesterday I got the email that I was accepted to Cal State Long Beach for my teaching credential program.
Congratulations. So, woo! That's wonderful, Seton. We're so proud of you. And those of you who don't know, we're going to be celebrating our graduates, which this year are Seton, Eric, and Silas on June 30th. I know you guys aren't going to be here, but please let Silas know. We'll have a cake. Anyone else here this morning that would like to lift up a prayer? Lindsay and then Ryan.
I have been working as a school nurse this year, and we just finished this week. And I don't have a job for next year at this point, and so I'm kind of just trying to figure out what's next. So I guess just direction in that and wisdom for that. And then also I have ADHD, and I have a lot of anxiety about just the unstructured time of summer. So it's so interesting. It's like, I'm so glad, and I'm like, don't know what to do and feel kind of like I don't, and that feeling is really hard. And so anyway, I don't know. I'm just feeling a lot of that and kind of feeling anxious about like this next season, even though I'm thankful for it. So just, I don't know, just that.
Thank you for sharing, Lindsay. I know you are not alone in those feelings. Ryan.
A couple things. We were just up in the mountains with Sebastian, so that was awesome. But we were out of cell phone range, and we found out that Willow was in the ER because her blood sugar skyrocketed, her pump malfunctioned, and her parents had to carry that weight. And I just wanted to thank them for that, because so yes, that, and also we are going to Mexico on Wednesday. Woot woot! And I want us to be safe, and I want us to have a good time, and I want us to recharge our batteries. So looking forward to that. And we also are running out of summers where we're going to have all our kids living with us, so we really need to maximize the time. So just wanted to pray for safe travels and family fun time is what I'll say.
And no more pump malfunctions for Willow. That would be lovely, too. Any other prayers here before we turn to Zoom? Looks like Caroline's on Zoom. Yeah. I pray for the families who lost the 215 Palestinian people and for the 4 Israeli families that got their hostages back, and with them all in grief and joy. Thank you, Caroline. Thank you so much. Heavy week this week, coming down the mountain and seeing news continuing the violence. Continued violence. Any other prayers on Zoom this morning? All right. Anyone else here? Last call. Let's pray together. There were a lot of prayers this morning. I'm not going to remember them all. So we're going to just pray a general prayer over everything that was spoken, because when you speak those words, God hears. Beautiful God, you've heard our voices this morning, voices of joy and pain and confusion and sorrow and hope and fear and curiosity and all of the other emotions that come into being human. We lift those prayers up. We lift those who've prayed up. We lift their families, their friends, their loved ones up to you. And we know, God, that our lives are filled with so much. So many things come at us all the time, and today when we've heard so many prayers, so many needs, so many joys, we just need to take a moment to breathe together and to let each one of those sharings enter our consciousness, enter our hearts, and move us to action, to rest, to feelings of peace within, to feelings of grief within. Let the words of your people move the people. So God, today, as we become community, sharing all of our diversity, all of the things that make us unique, and yet somehow finding the common thread that binds us all together, a thread of kindness and unity, a thread of interdependence, as Ray shared, a thread that weaves all through your creation, reminding us that no matter how different we are, no matter how much violence rages in the world, we are still your people. We are still showing up, holding our hearts in hope, believing in one another and in ourselves, that we can see a new way, the way that Jesus brought to us so long ago, the way that still has not been tested, the way that is our salvation. And for that, we give thanks. Amen.
Please stay seated and sit in your own reflection or prayer time, but also please join in singing Your Hands with us.
I have unanswered prayers.
I have unanswered prayers.
I have trouble I wish wasn't there.
I have trouble I wish wasn't there.
And I have asked a thousand ways.
And I have asked a thousand ways.
That you would take my pain away.
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 I am trying to understand.
I am trying to understand.
How to walk this weary land.
How to walk this weary land.
Before these feet of mine,
oh Lord, before.
Thank you. That was beautiful. I'm going to go barefoot today because my shoes are actually hurting my feet. So I'm going to take a little note from Ryan's playbook and just be without shoes. It's kind of nice. I'm liking it. All right, so before we jump into our scripture today, I want to say this scripture was not fun. And it's not one I would have picked if it wasn't part of our study. And so I had to sit with it all week. I spent more time working through this sermon than I usually do because of the challenge of the idea that grief unravels us. And in our scripture today, it's not just that private grief that we like to keep alone in our rooms and cry in the shower, but this is very public grief that is unraveling not just to the person who is experiencing the grief, but also to those who witness. So this was a heavy one. There were lots of reminders in the scripture of our collective violent history, is what I'm going to call it. We have a collective violent history. No people on the globe can say they aren't part of that violence. The scripture reminded me of our need to take revenge on each other, to get even with each other, to make our point, and to tell our own stories of victory at the expense of someone else's incredible grief and loss. And in light of the world that we live in today, frankly, this scripture feels very hollow to me. Because the violence continues. We haven't really learned from the violence of history. We just keep going around and around in these hamster wheels, experiencing over and over again the hurts of the past, the overwhelming nature of violence. And I'm wanting to let us know that the story I'm going to read in a moment is a little bit gruesome from Scripture. Not one of the most gruesome. I've read far more gruesome. It's going to refer to blood price, to feuds between historical enemies, and a very public mother's grief. Sometimes when the world is on fire, the only thing that can tame and deflate the unchecked violence is the utter and absolute grief of a mother. So we're going to read today from the second book of Samuel, and I need to remember the verses, but you'll see them up above as I read. All right. There's a tiny little verse that I can't find. Now Saul had a concubine whose name was Rizpah, daughter of Aiah. And that's the important part because we're wanting to name to you who Rizpah is. So the first king of Israel, Saul, Rizpah was one of his concubines. And Ishbal said to Abner, "Why have you gone into my father's concubine?" And then we're going to skip forward to chapter 21. David avenges the Gibeonites. We've had some historical shifts that have happened. Saul is no longer king. David has taken the throne. Now there was a famine in the days of David for 3 years, year after year, and David inquired of the Lord. The Lord said, "There is blood guilt on Saul and on his house because he put the Gibeonites to death." So the king called the Gibeonites and spoke to them. Now the Gibeonites were not of the people of Israel, but of the remnant of the Amorites. Although the people of Israel had sworn to spare them, Saul had tried to wipe them out in his zeal for the people of Israel and Judah. David said to the Gibeonites, "What shall I do for you? How shall I make expiation that you may bless the heritage of the Lord?" The Gibeonites said to him, "It is not a matter of silver or gold between us and Saul or his house. Neither is it for us to put anyone to death in Israel." He said, "What do you say that I should do for you?" They said to the king, "The man who consumed us and planned to destroy us so that we should have no place in all the territory of Israel, let 7 of his sons be handed over to us, and we will impale them before the Lord at Gibeon on the mountain of the Lord." The king said, "I will hand them over." But the king spared Mephibosheth, the son of Saul's son, Jonathan, because of the oath of the Lord that was between them. between David and Jonathan, son of Saul. The king took the two sons of Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, whom she bore to Saul, Armani and Mephisobeth, and the five sons of Merab, daughter of Saul, whom she bore to Adriel, son of Barzillai, the Metholite. He gave them into the hands of the Gibeonites, and they impaled them on the mountain before the Lord. The seven of them perished together. They were put to death in the first 7 days of harvest at the beginning of barley harvest. Then Rizpah, the daughter of Aiah, took sackcloth and spread it on a rock for herself from the beginning of harvest until rain fell on them from the heavens. She did not allow the birds of the air to come on the bodies by day or the wild animals by night. When David was told what Rizpah, daughter of Aiah, the concubine of Saul, had done, David went and took the bones of Saul and the bones of his son Jonathan from the people of Jabesh-Gilead, who had stolen them from the public square of Beth-shan, where the Philistines had hung them up on the day the Philistines killed Saul on Gilboa. He brought up from there the bones of Saul and the bones of his son Jonathan, and they gathered the bones of those who had been impaled. They buried the bones of Saul and of his son Jonathan in the land of Benjamin and Zelah, in the tomb of his father Kish. They did all that the king commanded. After that, God heeded supplications for the land. Whew. Anyone need a little explanation? All right, let's do it. So here's what's happening in this scripture. After King Saul's death, and David has now claimed the throne, a famine comes into the land. And in the old world, and still in the world today, there's a lot of belief that when some natural disaster hits, that it is God punishing the ones who are affected by that natural disaster, or in this case, famine. We do not believe that, just to make that clear. That is what the people in Scripture had belief in. We personally do not, in this church, I haven't heard any of you say that you believe a famine would mean God is punishing some. Famine means that the chosen people are suffering from the sins of the past. That's what it means to these people. And so David speaks to God and learns that there is blood guilt on the previous King Saul and his house, because he promised not to kill the Gibeonites, but then tried to. And David does a new thing and goes to those who were harmed, the Gibeonites, and asks them, how can this be made right? Have we ever been in that situation where you've done harm to someone and someone asks, or you had harm done to you and someone says, how can we make it right? It's not always easy to answer, is it? Because we like revenge. Let's just be honest. We like to know that the people who hurt us are going to hurt. And so the response here is, let's impale the sons of Saul. That'll make us feel better about our loss if we cause more loss to someone else. We don't want silver or gold. We want the blood of the one who, quote, consumed us and planned to destroy us so we would have no place in all of Israel. We want his blood. He's gone, so we want the blood of his sons. But because of the previous oath between David and Jonathan, who was Saul's son, and Saul, they had to take the lesser sons. Remember, they were concubines that Saul had. Lots of wives, all of whom bore him sons, but they were not the most important sons. They were the lesser sons. And so from the concubine of Saul, Rizpah, they took the blood of two of her sons. The idea being to take the blood of the innocent to pay for the bloodlust of the guilty. Does that make sense? Nope, still doesn't make sense. And if they're not guilty, we're paying the bloodlust of those who are deeply aggrieved, because we could make the argument that the Gibeonites were deeply saddened by the loss that they had suffered. And in an attempt to feel better, they know nothing other than to cause more violence and more harm. I'm not so sure we've come very far since those days, looking at the situation in our world, looking at our own relationships and how sometimes it's hard to set things right when we have been hurt. But in our story today, Rizpah enters. and her grief will not be contained. And we imagine that grief of that mother who lost, for no reason, two sons. Her sons have been taken unjustly, murdered and impaled on the mountain, left for the birds and the wild animals. What would you do with that kind of grief? So this mother, all on her own, spreads sackcloth and keeps a vigil for months up on the mountain by herself, not allowing the birds to touch the bodies of those impaled. She stays there from the beginning of the harvest until the rains come, or until her grief was enough to unravel the hearts of those who live by bloodlust. It took a long time for them to see her. And it must have been a very lonely and scary time for her up on the mountain. What a courageous woman to defy the decision of a king. This is courage. No weapons, no companions, just Rizpah on her own with her unending grief, howling on the mountain. And after months, David's heart is moved, and he takes the bodies and bones down to be properly buried. This was all he could do in that moment. There was no giving her son back. There was nothing that could be done to truly set right the grief of this mother. And yet he does what can be done. And then the supplications for the famine to end were somehow heard by God. So I'll be honest again, I don't like this. I don't like this scripture at all. Using the blood of some to pay for the blood of others, when the hell does it end? Still going on today. How many more mothers have to howl in grief while the rest of the world stands unmoved by their pain? How many more? Why do we want more pain to soothe our own pain? That's a hard one. We may not be causing death and destruction, but still, sometimes the only thing that makes us feel better is to know that the person who hurt us is hurting too. Why are we like that? Why does hearing the heart wrench of one make us feel better? Or does it? When can we stop and finally say, no more? Not in my name. No more death in my name. And so in my angry meditations this week, I remembered the ones who stayed at the cross with Jesus. Who were they? The women. And John, the beloved one. The women. The ones who stayed had no control over the violence that had been done or would be done. They had no control over the outcomes of the violence. They stayed with Jesus just as Rizpah stayed with her sons. They refused to leave, and they allowed grief to unravel them. They allowed grief to open them, and I am sure these powerful women would not have asked for blood price to be paid for their grief, because they stood and they let themselves feel it all. Because in the unraveling, we are changed. We don't ask for grief. Nobody wants grief. But if we allow ourselves, when grief hits us, to be unraveled by it, then we are forever changed. We as grief-stricken individuals who have allowed the unraveling of our hearts, we are the medicine for a world racked by and trapped in violence. We are the medicine when we let ourselves fully grieve. If we don't allow the grief to come through us, then what happens to it in our systems? It gets stuck, it gets trapped, and it turns into anger. Anger unexpressed turns into incredible violence, like we've seen in the scripture today. Many of you here were witnesses of my fairly public unraveling by grief that happened about 5 years ago. And I'm going to share it again because it was public and it was grief-stricken And I was forever changed by it. And that's what the purpose of our story is today. Or at least the purpose I could find in the violence. So about 5 years ago, I was at a point of incredible stress in my life here at the church, having just moved, and lots of things were going wrong, and lots of people were being unkind. And then one afternoon, my daughter went to a doctor's appointment with her dad, and we heard the shocking and horrible words that she's a type 1 diabetic. Totally out of the blue for us. No expectation at all that that was what this checkup was going to be. It was just supposed to be a regular checkup they had to do before going back to school in the fall. And I remember sitting alone on the edge of my bed because they were at the doctor's office while I had been here cleaning up vacation Bible school with Jeanette. And I felt so alone, nowhere to put the grief and everything welling up. And many of you have shared today about different chronic conditions and disabilities and things that all of a sudden shift your whole life in a heartbeat. And I remember sitting at the edge of my bed, not able to move, not able to cry, just kind of stuck and stunned for a very, very long time, waiting for them to come home. And of course, we did what we had to do. It was 2 days in the hospital, spending the night there with an 8-year-old who was hooked up to machines and hurting and scared, having to be strong, having to hold through that, knowing that our whole life was going to change, and we didn't know how, but we just had to move with the change. And just as we came home and started getting our bearings together over those next 2 weeks, I got a phone call one Saturday morning that my best friend and colleague, who had been struggling with ovarian cancer, died suddenly in the night because she had a sudden onset of pneumonia. I knew my friend was unwell, and I knew we were likely going to lose her within the year, but I wasn't ready to lose her 2 weeks after my daughter's diagnosis. Still have the text messages that we shared back and forth. She was too weak to talk, and so she would send me messages of love and care and comfort for my daughter, and to lose her at that moment felt like, are you just trying to kill me, God? Who's felt that way in your life? Where it's just like, really? Another thing on top of the other thing on top of the other thing. I went a little crazy that day. My husband and kids remember. Apparently, I was screaming at the neighbor because they had a terrible Airbnb, and it was just a nightmare the night before. And I apparently terrified a man much larger than me, so much so he wouldn't even come out to speak to me. I lost it. I publicly lost it. And I'm so glad. I'm so glad I did when I look back on that moment. Because frankly, they deserved it. They were being disrespectful. Right? They were being awful. And I had all this grief in me. And it had to go somewhere. It had to go somewhere. So at least he has a funny story to tell about the crazy lady that was screaming about throwing her dog poop over the fence if they didn't fix the thing. I'm going to make it miserable for anyone who stays in this Airbnb, and on and on and on. And I didn't even remember all the crazy things that came out my mouth that day. But I had to let the feeling that was in me up and out, because if I hadn't, it could have crippled me. It could have actually taken me out, and it almost did. I used to hold the hurt feeling like I was succeeding by not falling apart, by not letting the tears fall down my face publicly, by feeling like, I'm strong enough, you're sad, but I can handle this. And I felt like I was the successful one because I didn't cry and I didn't feel, and I could just push through, not express what was inside of me. But then all of a sudden, in this moment of my life, it was such overwhelming grief, and it hit me so powerfully that it actually knocked me over, and no longer could I hold the edges of my grief tightly. Now they were spilling out everywhere I went because I'd been holding them at the time for like 41 years. No outlet for this kind of grief. So in being knocked over, I was unraveled completely from the inside out. I couldn't find words for months after. I could barely read. I looked at words and finally could figure them out, but my brain was not functioning. I felt like a zombie for months and months. Maybe if I'm honest, sometimes I still feel like a zombie when I go back to thinking of those times. Because those overwhelming griefs that rip through us, they're not just the grief that's ripping through you in the moment, but what do they do to all the other stored griefs within? They pull them right to the surface. And now all of a sudden, all around you is every grief and every pain of your life swirling, and all you can do is sleep, right? Is sit, is let yourself be. And I wasn't very good at sleeping and sitting and letting myself be. But grief brought me to that point of unraveling where I had no other option. And our unraveling griefs don't need to be so dramatic as Rizpah's, or even as dramatic as the one I just shared. But they're real, and they're in us, and we need to spend some time getting in touch with them. So for our discussion today, if we could pull the questions up, I want us to take a few minutes to just reflect together and to bear witness to those who are ready to share a grief. This can be a small grief, spilled milk. It can be a big grief, but I want you to spend some time today just naming them. Our first question is, how do you feel about public grief? Why do you think it's difficult for people to express grief publicly? Maybe you could ask yourself, do you judge people who express grief publicly? The ones who cry openly at funerals, do you judge them? Ask yourself that question. Have you ever been inspired to action through witnessing grief? Maybe your own grief or the grief of someone else. And the third one, what do you think might change in our world if more of us were more willing to share grief publicly? So those are the three questions. Notice you don't have to answer personally, but you can, and that's what I am encouraging you all to do. It's not easy, but when you do it, it creates space inside of you for healing to happen. So if you don't feel comfortable sharing about your own personal grief, then you can see that there are ways to talk about grief in a more distanced way here. So let's take a few minutes, get into a group. Don't forget our new people. We have some new people here today. Welcome. And before we get into groups, for those of you who are new, you do not have to share. You can just listen. You also are very welcome to share. We love to hear what you have to say. Okay? You ready? Let's go. All right, my friends, are we ready to gather back? Wow, you guys really rearranged the sanctuary today. Okay, I'm going to just start putting the microphone in people's faces who are still talking. Okay, you guys can actually leave your chairs like that. That's fine. Who wants to share what your group discussed? There were some great conversations. I'm glad we're talking about grief. Who's going to share in our new circle, our circle within the circle? Eric's going to share. All right, let's hear what Eric has to say.
Hello, everyone. We talked a lot about just the sharing of grief in public and how it's something that we are expected to keep to ourselves a lot of the time. Like you're perfectly welcome to show joy and anger and, you know, every other emotion, but once you get to the sad end of the spectrum of emotions, it's supposed to just, you know, cut off. And sadness is just as valid as every other emotion you experience, and it's a whole range of emotions that you should be sharing with people around you. Mm-hmm. We talked a lot about I had an experience recently with someone who, I'll recap quickly, but I basically ran into the father of someone I went to high school with. Last month, I ran into him, and through talking with him, after a few minutes, I learned that the person I went to high school with died in November. And he kind of told it to me like it was a secret. Like, he kind of whispered it to me. Like, he came in really close and told me that he died. And he felt the need to apologize for feeling sad and for crying and for grieving. And I literally, like, took him by the shoulder and stared him in the eye. And I was like, do not apologize to me about feeling sad. I understand how you're feeling. Like, please, like, tell me about Jake. Like, tell me what you remember about him. Tell me why you're sad. And we talked for like half an hour after that, just about this whole experience of being grieving. And somehow he hadn't experienced that yet in his life. And like, I'm grateful for him for that. Like, that's a lucky experience. But just, I don't know, if you share more openly the terrible things that you're going through, then you'll connect with people who have also gone through those terrible things and prepare people who haven't gone through them for when they inevitably do go through them. And both of those things are things I didn't have when I went through my formative grief process when I was 12. And it's a core part of who I am, for better and worse. So it's it's just a lot of thoughts bouncing around in here.
Wow, Eric, that was beautiful.
Thank you.
That was beautiful. Thank you for sharing. And thank you for being present for that man who needed someone to hold him while he had a moment of grief. Shelby. All right.
Our table talked about why we think it is difficult for people to express grief publicly. And we realized that it was because a lot of the time there's just no space given for it. Mm-hmm. Like you're saying, like, our community is here, open up, so that when we express grief, we feel held. But not every community is like that. I'm thinking this school community. Like, if you express grief, it is being vulnerable. And it's really, really hard to be publicly vulnerable, especially in all the different spaces in our culture that, you know, don't have things set up so that people feel held and feel supported and heard. And so it's not like it's, oh, us, like, you know, not doing something right by not expressing it or feeling like we need to be private. I feel like it's everything else that has come together to say that, like, oh, this vulnerable side of you, like, you're not good enough if you show that.
Thank you. That's beautiful. I'm so glad that we're seeing that some places are set up to hold us and other places aren't. That's one of the first ways to safely and publicly express grief, is to know you're safe. So thank you for seeing that, Shelby. Anyone else? Those are some great shares already, and then we'll go to Zoom. One more? Bronwyn? I'm gonna walk her way, and then she'll... You wanna share, Ben?
All right, so we talked about grief and how it related to the story, and how it was tied with all the symbolism in the story, which had a revenge arc in it. It had a suffering arc in it. And I think Lauren made a really interesting comment about memorials and how they're put down for a reason, to be looked at symbolically and... What's that? And sometimes it makes us feel better. Yeah.
Thank you, Ben.
And help us avoid grief sometimes. We also talked about the complexity that in the story, what's her name, Rizpah?
Rizpah, yeah.
Is grieving over these sons that have been taken from her and killed. But in the story, actually murdering them makes everything better. It does, the famine goes away, the rift between the people group is repaired. And so operating from there, it's one of those situations where she is so bereft in where everything's good. You shouldn't be sad. Look what's happened. Look at all these good things. And I think in all different ways, we all have an experience of grieving in the midst of you shouldn't be sad situation and the tension of being able to be honest with your own grief and holding to it like she does so passionately and in such an isolated way in the middle of good things. Mm. You know, that's
beautiful. Thank you. All right. Any other shares? Did you want to say anything from Zoom?
On Zoom, we talked about, I talked about my dad's funeral and how we flew back to Pittsburgh. It was very sudden. It's very shocking. And I had never cried, really, before that time. And we went to the church, and what really got me was my parents were part of like a bell choir at their church. And so the choir was on the other side of town. They would have to drive like an hour to get to the church where my dad was going to have the service. And they all showed up. And they all played this beautiful song. And I just remember breaking down in tears and just making an embarrassing, awesome scene. And just being in it. And then I remember this lady sitting behind me that kind of shamed me talking to her partner about how loud I was being. And I wanted to strangle this woman. And it basically talks about the idea of, even at my dad's funeral, I got shamed for publicly grieving in the funeral. Like, where else am I supposed to do it? So it's just like a wider narrative about our culture. It's like we, and Shelby said it, we do not create space to grieve. And even when we do create the space, Bronwyn talked about how it can be an excuse to not grieve. Let's celebrate the life. Fine, but I'm grieving too.
Yeah.
So I think it can be both. And I think that's us just taking the intentionality and saying, if I feel sad and I feel like grieving, I'm going to do it. And shame me away, but I'm going to do it anyway. So.
Amen. Any other shares? Stephanie wants to share. Oh, great, Stephanie. All right. Can you guys hand that back to her?
I shared with the group a personal grief that happened on D-Day, June 6th. My mother's brother, my uncle, was killed in World War II. He was 19 years old, and I had put it on social media, remembering, you know, that it was D-Day. And a distant cousin contacted me and said that he had been killed storming the beaches of Normandy. And it just brought back this grief that even though I never met him, he died before I was born. It made me sad.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, we grieve ancestrally. It doesn't just end with us. Any other sharing?
Yes.
Someone on Zoom. All right. We can hear you.
Well, in our time of polycrisis, you know, genocides around the world and climate chaos, so frequently we wonder how we can be so numb to daily atrocity and impending doom. And I really believe that it is unmetabolized grief and rage all the way back. You know, and people who would shame us are, you know, they're enforcing a social order, but they're also jealous that we might have access to our real feelings and access to who we really are. And it's a matter of authenticity and power. And so it's powerful and important to grieve. As well as to be in touch with fear and shame and anger, and not to harm others with, but to learn from, because our feelings are God-given. And, you know, even though, I mean, I really appreciate what Bronwyn said about, you know, Rizpah it went well for the people. You know, the famine ended, but only when her grief had run its course, and only when those in power acknowledged her loss also.
Caroline, you're kind of doing a good sum up of our conversation. I want to just say in closing that we are safe here at Harbor to allow our grief that is sometimes disguised as anger. We talked a little bit about that in our group, that sometimes grief is underneath the anger. And so in this place, it's okay to express your anger. It's okay to express your grief. It's okay. And I want to really make sure we say that. We heard our young people say today, they don't have a place to do this in the world. And I'm often struck with, what's the point of the church in this world? Right? Y'all are theologians. You can go on, you can find information, you can do your theological thought. You don't need to come to church for that. Why do we come to church? It's because Jesus taught us to weave ourselves into community, because that's how we process. A few weeks ago, I shared with y'all how depressed I've been. And it's not because there's anything really bad in my life. It's just like Caroline said, there's a lot of unmetabolized anger and fear and grief in the world. And some of us are sensitive people and we feel it. And I was feeling it. And after I shared with you how I was feeling, which is a little weird for the senior pastor to do that, right? Most of you probably haven't had a pastor do that. And I almost didn't do it because I thought, no, I shouldn't do that. I shouldn't publicly tell the truth on myself. Well, guess what? Since that sharing, many of you have come to me and thanked me. I'm feeling it too. And now I don't feel as alone because we're feeling it together. Instead of me all by myself, all by my lonesome, like Rizpah up on the mountain, howling at the animals so that they don't take the flesh of her sons. I'm not alone. I got a community that can hold me when I'm grieving. And then I can turn around and hold them when they're grieving. That's how it works. And we're doing that here at Harbor. And the way we do it is we don't shame people for their very real emotions, including if someone comes in here angry and ragey, mad at the world, and needs to work through the anger before they can drop into the grief. We accept that. We don't take it personally. We know that that person's rage actually has nothing to do with me. It has to do with their unmetabolized pain and grief that we all have. Not a single person here doesn't have that. But when we learn together as community how to take steps towards metabolizing it together, I love that word that Caroline used, metabolizing the grief. When we take those steps, we heal just a little, which makes a little more room for movement and space, and it inspires someone else to take their step, and then someone else to take their step. And before you know it, we're actually allowing the grief to move through our own bodies and spirits, and it doesn't feel lonely. It feels connected. Does that make sense? Do we see what happens when we're able to express those emotions? So I just think it's so beautiful that our young people see that. Because the truth is that some of our older generations, and my generation included, we have had to numb ourselves to the pain in the world, because there has been so much. And I say to Ryan often about his dad, who served in Vietnam as a Green Beret. He had to have seen some heavy things and probably done some things too. The best gift he could give his family that he dearly loved was to close the door on that and lock it up, because it was too much. And so the children of those who had this suffering in violence and war were the ones that have to feel it. We're the ones that have to let it move through our system so that we can heal the world. And this is work that each one of you can do. Stephanie shared someone she didn't even know, but was able to get herself to that place of beautiful grief to release that pain from history for a family member that she didn't personally know. And yet, because of our ancestry, we are. That's a beautiful story of how we heal the hurts of the past without judgment,
without looking at our grandparents and our great-grandparents and our great-great-grandparents and telling them that you're wrong and bad. No, they're not. They had to numb themselves because the pain was too much. And now we're in a world where if we don't start feeling it, if we don't start expressing it, it's just going to re-entrench, and we're going to see the same cycles 1,000 years from now. It takes courage to do what Rizpah did, to go up on the hill by yourself, to be the only one willing to scream and howl your hurt and your pain. But when we do that, we inspire somebody else to do the same. And then another and another. And before you know it, we're crying together for all the hurts through the centuries, all the hurts, which clears space for the joy. And that brings us, normally we do a poem a little earlier in service. So Eric, if you could pull the poem up, I wanted to do it now after our discussion to kind of close us out. It's one of my favorite poems, again, by Khalil Gibran. I have that book, The Prophet, that has been a meaningful poem. If you'd like to move your chairs around while we're getting ready, that's fine. That talks about the connection between joy and sorrow, and that in fact, they go together. And we have to learn to tend to both our joys and our sorrows. So I'm really happy to invite Sebastian up to read for us this morning our poem.
Good morning. On joy and sorrow. Then a woman said, "Speak to us of joy and sorrow." And he answered, "Your joy is your sorrow unmasked. And the selfsame well from which your laughter rises was oftentimes filled with your tears. And how else can it be? The deeper that sorrow carves into your being, the more joy you can contain. Is not the cup that holds your wine the very cup that was burned in the potter's oven? And is not the lute that soothes your spirit the very wood that was hollowed with knives? When you are joyous, look deep into your heart, and you shall find it is only that which has given you sorrow that is giving you joy. When you are sorrowful, look again in your heart, and you shall see that in truth you are weeping for that which has been your delight. Some of you say, joy is greater than sorrow. And others say, nay, sorrow is the greater. But I say unto you, they are inseparable. Together they come, and when one sits alone with you at the board, remember that the other is asleep upon your bed. Verify you are suspended like scales between your sorrows and your joy. Only when you are empty are you at still stand and balanced. When the treasure keeper lifts you the way to weigh his gold and his silver, needs must your joy or your sorrow rise or fall.
Thank you, Sebastian, for reading that so beautifully. And before our praise team takes over with a beautiful song, it is the second Sunday, and we offer to our community that if anyone is ready to place membership with Harbor, now is the time. I'm just going to wait a moment, and if you would like to, after reflecting on the song, if you feel like you're ready to say, I'm with these people, then I'll invite you to come forward at the end of the song. And if not, we're still going to have a cake after today to celebrate birthdays and new members. And thank you so much for listening and being a part of our really deep discussion today.
Please stay seated as we sing through There Is a Balm in Gilead.
There is a balm in
Thank you. That was beautiful. All right. Any takers this morning? All right. That's okay. I would like to invite Ray up to read our invitation for communion.
We gather around a lot of tables in this world, and each of them has a different hold on us. At the lunch table, we see our friends, but we also may see our insecurity. At the conference table, we may dream big dreams, but we also may see competition or fear. At the family table, we see love and laughter and conversation, but we also may see seats that are empty or hear silence that feels lonely. We gather around a lot of tables in this world, but there is none like this one. Here at this table, we can bring the different pieces of ourselves, our dreams and our joy, our fear and our insecurity, our pain and our hurt, and they will be welcome. Here at this table, we show up hungry and we always leave fed. Here at this table, we are met by a God who says, "Come in, come in. The food is ready and the table is set. This chair has your name on it. We've been waiting just for you." Friends, there are a lot of tables in this world, but there is none like this one. We have saved a seat for you. Come.
Thank you. So here's this table. Today, it's adorned with all the colors of the rainbow, reminding us that this is not our table. This is the table that Christ invites us to. There's a seat for each one, no matter who you are, no matter how you've walked, no matter what you've done or not done. There's a seat here. And all we have to do to take our seat at this table is to agree that everyone else deserves a seat at this table too. That's it. And that's a lot to ask for some people. But I want us through this month of June, where we celebrate Pride, to use the rainbow as a reminder that this table is for everyone. All the colors of the world, each one has a place here at this beloved table. In our community, all are welcome to communion. You don't have to go through tests or any kind of rules in order to partake. So if you're new this week, you are very, very welcome to come forward, take your elements, and then return to your seat, and we will take them all together as I share the words of institution. So if you're ready, Ray, will you serve the communion? And we do have some gluten-free communion. So if you are a person who wants gluten-free, please take or let Ray know that you would like the gluten-free, and she will hand that to you. Come forward when you're ready. Right here. No. Did everyone get? All right.
have to admit, I kind of like the days we almost run out of communion because it means we're growing as a community. So that's a good thing. All right. So on that night, Jesus gathered in the upper room with his dear friends, and they were grieving, and they were also struck in awe by this amazing man who was showing them a new way to love each other. It was all there, joy and sorrow. When Jesus blessed the bread and broke it, saying, "This is my body. This is my body. We don't need any more sacrifice. We can just share the bread." And he broke it, said, "Take and eat this and remember me." And then he took the cup and he blessed it and he poured it out, saying, "We don't need any more blood sacrifice. We can share the cup and create a new covenant where we love one another, where we forgive one another. May it be so." Will you please pray the Lord's Prayer with me? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. All right, well, we have a few announcements. We'll make them brief because we're going a little long today. Have our weekly gatherings going on this week. We're leaving on Wednesday, so men's group can't happen. Women's group will still be on Tuesday. Small group questionnaire. This went out in your newsletter, and we would love to hear from you all what types of small groups you would like to start seeing pop up here at Harbor. So if you could take a few moments to answer these questions, you can find them in the newsletter. If you need, you can also, in the Eccleston room, there we're scrolling the announcements, and you can use the QR code with your phone. And there's a sign on the community table. Thank you, Lauren. Tie-dye shirt fundraiser. We are going to be giving money to the LGBTQ Center of OC and also preparing for Pride Parade, which will be happening in Santa Ana in October. If you would like to contribute to that, buy a tie-dye shirt from Pat and also thank Pat. She's not here today, but thank Pat for the beautiful altar covering that she made with her art of tie-dye. And right after service today, we are going to have our dear friend Sebastian lead us in a heart opening ceremony. You'll get to learn a little bit more about him and the work he does in Tepoztlan, Mexico, running men's groups and helping people access some of their heart emotion. So we're going to be doing that today. We're going to use a little bit of cacao, which is basically what chocolate is made from. So don't be alarmed by that, but come and just experience this. We're going to have music, we're going to have play and fun, and I hope that even a small group gathering is enough, but I hope that several of you will stay. We'll be doing that just a few minutes after we're done with our worship time. And then we have a meeting this evening for those of you who would like to help Ryan the first week of Blue Theology, which starts on June 22nd. We would love for you to gather on Zoom tonight from 7 to 9, any questions you have. There's a lot of new things happening this year, and you will be able to get an understanding of what that looks like, and that's tonight from 7 to 9. If you want to be a part of it but aren't able to make the meeting, please make sure you talk to Ryan today, and he'll set up a time to talk before we leave for our vacation, because as soon as we're back, then Blue Theology starts, so we want to connect with you before we leave. All right, and then our grad celebration will be on Sunday, June 30th, celebrating Eric, Seton, and Silas right after church. And is that it? Ryan, you had one other thing, right?
So that Blue Theology Zoom link will go out this afternoon, so whoever is looking for that, it will be this afternoon. It's in the email. Can we send another one? Like a separate one, or
it's in the Sunday email.
Is it in Sunday?
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, wow. You were doing work Lauren's when I got was it going. All. I was like, wow, all right. Listen to Lauren.
So your Sunday Harbor Christian email, if you scroll down, you'll see all the Zoom links and all of the announcements every week.
Great. Also, I got a request from our intern, Natalie, who was at Pepperdine, and she was wondering if there's anybody that has a spare bedroom that she could stay close to the church during those Blue Theology weeks. So I just wanted to throw that out there. If anybody has room, she'd love to be close because she's in Encinitas, and that's probably an hour. All right.
That was easy.
Wow.
Thank you.
One other thing, I'm going to take liberties here. I want us to celebrate Sadie. Because she is the one who helped us create this church, and I've been in a lot of churches, and this church is by far, and I'm biased a little bit.
Yeah, he's really
by
biased.
By far the best church I've ever been in. It feels like Jesus is here with us. So I think we should wish her and sing for her a happy birthday.
All right. Thank you. I will receive this. It's not easy for me, but I will.
Can we get some accompaniment? There we go. Happy
birthday. And Heather. It's her birthday, too.
And Heather, too.
And Heather. Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate that. I was also so happy to learn I have a birthday twin in the house, another Gemini. It's really fun. So thank you. Geminis rule. And we also can be a little problematic too. I know that. Okay, is that it for our announcements? All right, will you please join us in singing our closing hymn?
I forgot we have to do that.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be with God. Walk with each other in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow. To take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally.
Be so. Will you please join me in our joint benediction? Creator God, who holds us in the unraveling, we ask for strength, bravery, and grace as we leave this place. May we continue to walk in the knowledge that you are always with us. Impart your wisdom, fill our hearts with curiosity and longing, and allow us to feel your presence, especially during our times of unraveling. May we find the courage to get out of the boat, to laugh at the impossible that God makes possible, and to speak of our faith confidently. And when the world falls apart, may we hear God's voice deep within saying, "Take heart, it is I, be not afraid." We are called, we are blessed in both our ups and our downs. We always belong to God. Go now in peace. Go trusting that good news. Amen. Thank you for joining us today. Please join us for snacks. We have cakes to celebrate birthdays and new members.